All right, so today we're working on the spring head here, and I've got the shower board right there to make a cul-de-sac form, and I have the rebar here driven in already, and to hold back the shower board. And the reason why I put the rebar in here first, and I set the shower board in here to figure out where I wanted it to go, and then I drove in the rebar so that we know exactly what we're going to cut out and what we're not, because I don't want to cut out too much of the spring. I just want to cut out just enough to make the cul-de-sac area. Then we're going to fill this with some pea gravel and put in a what's that pot that we got?
It's a terracotta pot.
Terracotta pot that we're going to put in here and make what's called a zero pot, which is used for keeping vegetables and stuff cool. Or a lot of people may recognize it as a spring-fed or spring-cooled fridge, which is what we're going to put in here. And then after it goes through and creates the spring cooler or spring fridge, then we'll recollect the water on this side of the from the cul-de-sac. We'll put in a funnel that collects the water into a pipeline, running it down the creek to the fresh water tank. And point to the clay stuff. And what Addie's collecting right now is where it's bits of sandy clay, and we're hoping that this clay will be good enough to make some pottery out of. We have this kind of stuff all up and down our creek, this creek and our other creek, and it's all over our yard. But this is the best bit of clay that we've seen so far, and where she's picking it out, we do have to carve this out, because we want to take this. Right now it's a big slope, and we want to cut it a straight vertical up and down so that we have some depth to put in our pots to make the kitchen area, or not the kitchen area, sorry, the refrigerator for our zero pot system. And so she's trying to salvage the clay that we can so that it doesn't get washed downstream and unusable. I think this actually, here's a chunk here.
Cool. Some of it may be rotten. You can see some of it. It's bendy and flexible, that clay, but then it's on like a rock too.
Yeah, there's a lot of sandstone and I think shell. I think it's sandstone and shell.
No, shell's darker. Shell's compressed together.
Either way, it's real easy to break apart and use, and it's real porous. So we do know that this spring is extremely clean, because there's a lot of crayfish and salamanders living in it, and those are indicator species.
Yeah.
If there was anything wrong with our water, then the salamanders would all be dead.
Or have like six legs or something.
Or be deformed or something, and the crawfish as well. So they wouldn't be here, and we wouldn't have frogs and stuff like that. Anything with that slimy type skin is very susceptible to diseases and stuff, and
the chemical goes right through their skin. They're used to absorbing water and oxygen through their skin, so that doesn't stop a lot of stuff from going in. So if there's a lot of the different toxins and pollutions that would be in water would screw them up.
And all of ours seem to be really healthy and good at the moment. So
I'm not gonna say happy, because they're usually like, oh God, I'm gonna die.
So I initially busted free all this big heavy rock here I carved out. And then I found the whole big nest full of salamanders and clay, so I called Addie down here, because she likes to play with the salamanders, and she's been wanting clay, so she's collecting the clay now.
I like mud.
And I needed a break for my back. As soon as she carves out this...
Are we moving these rocks?
Yes.
Alright, well, be prepared, because there's a big salamander in there.
As soon as she... it's done with her portion of collecting the clay and stuff, then we will I'll get in there and clean it out and do the final touches, add the shower board, and then we'll bring down the buckets of gravel. With any luck, we'll have the zero pot portion completed tonight, and I've got to figure out how we're going to do the lid, because we are going to put a roof on this thing, an insulated roof, where we're going to use the same kind of shower board as that right there, but we're going to put a styrofoam cover on basically two sheets of the shower board with a thick styrofoam between the two sheets. So it'll go the shower board, styrofoam, shower board. And then that way it creates an insulated cover. Not the biggest deal, but the idea is to keep the as much cool, as much as the cold inside this gravel cul-de-sac as possible. And no, it will not freeze in the winter time because it's flowing water. Flowing water doesn't freeze. And we won't be trapping all of the water into our pipeline going down to the tank. We're only going to trap, we'll probably see how much water is flowing out of there right now and see how much water is flowing out of the 3-liter funnel. We'll probably trap about as much, maybe twice as much water that's flowing out of the funnel right now.
Don't eat the chickens, Kyle.
About twice as much water is flowing out of that 3-liter right now is the goal to capture, which is only about a third of the amount of water that's flowing out of the whole spring. So we're only going to catch about a third, and two-thirds of it's going to flow through the zeropot and over the cul-de-sac and around the cul-de-sac and back through. The shower board that's making the cul-de-sac is only to hold back enough water to keep the zeropot refrigerator system cold. And the spring is approximately
54 degrees or so.
Well, the last time I tested it, it was 42.
Yeah, it depends on the ambient temperature too.
But. So it was like almost 90 degrees outside when I checked the when I checked the temperature of the spring, and it was like almost 90 outside and about 42 degrees for the spring.
Yeah, I checked it when it was cold outside.
So it should be keep vegetables and cheese at just the right temperature, your sauces, like your salad dressings. So if you want to keep like hot dogs, you would be able to keep in here for a few days if the animals don't get to it, and stuff like that. So we do have a we're going to get a container that we can like an animal proof container that we can put
small galvanized tin or something.
Yeah, that we can put sealed stuff in, like hot dogs. If you take a package of hot dogs and don't open it, then you can put it in a number 10 coffee can, and then with the lid on it and stick it in here and whatnot, and it'll keep it cool and it'll keep the animals out, stuff like that. Where's this salamander? Did he run off?
It must have headed farther up, but it was at least as thick as my thumb. I was excited.
Okay, well, we're going to turn this off for now, and then we'll turn you back on when we get more done. Large salamander here. There we go. Can't pick him up. Okay. No, don't go down in there. It's gonna get hurt. Need to move you to safety. Ralph, go. Here's your big salamander, friend. Come get your salamander friend first.
Whoa, wow.
Just get your salamander friend first.
Okay. I'm gonna give you this, or I'm gonna stick it under my arm. Hey, little sailor. Not actually little, you're pretty big. You're pretty cool. Come here.
Yes,
oh, you're a slick thinker. I'm not gonna call you anything else. But you really do not want to be hanging out in there, because you're going to get squashed.
I don't know where he went.
Under this, probably.
Oh, if he's under the big rock, he should be fine, man.
I saw the whirlpool right in here.
Okay.
Well, he's out of the way somewhere, at least now.
Well, he should be safe now if he's under that big rock.
Yeah.
Alright, so we have finished digging it out. We dug out the cul-de-sac for him. We dug a trench along where the shower board goes in, and now we're going to start filling in. Now that we put the shower board in, we're going to start filling in clay and sand on the into the trench on the outside of the shower board and on the inside to kind of seal it up. It's not going to stop all the water from coming out from underneath it, but the idea is to slow it down enough so that when we fill this full of gravel, it will fill up with water and overflow from the top more so than coming out from the bottom. And we don't want to pour concrete on this because concrete is a permanent structure and it completely changes and alters our tax evaluation and whatnot, or whatever it's called. Once you pour concrete, then you have to have inspections and you have to have people come out and issue you permits and everything for what you're doing. So there will be no concrete used. We're using clay and sand to mold what we need to mold. And the only thing we've done is drive in four pieces of rebar and use one piece of shower board. And we have not touched the actual spring itself. We haven't touched. All the water comes in from in there, and currently it's pouring in through a 3-liter bottle that we have to trap it. But once we get this done, that 3-liter bottle will come out, and we will hook up a different type of funnel source to capture our water into our pipeline. This way, the spring is kept all natural, and we can use it for multi-purposes without altering the ground, without permanently altering the ground, and therefore it's not regulatable, there's nothing to be permitted, and there's nothing permanent being done here. And that's the key thing, is once you start pouring concrete and making permanent changes and permanent alterations to the ground, then you are then susceptible to taxation and guidelines and restrictions and all kinds of stuff. So we just had a frog hop up in there. Let's go check him out. Yeah, he just hopped up in to get a shower. Daddy says hello, Mr. Frog, or Mrs. Frog, whatever. So, alrighty. Addie's currently bringing down the stuff to fill in here.
The shower board scooted away from the rebar.
That piece of rebar is just slightly off.
Okay.
So, when it fills with gravel, it'll push into like it's supposed to. I had the rebar slightly bent outwards because I want the shower board to have a slight slope to it outwards. So, you gotta bend this one a little. There we go. Alrighty, so it's coming along. We'll have it done this evening. We'll have this part done this evening. May not have the pipeline done tonight, but we'll definitely have that done tomorrow if it's not raining. So, alrighty. Alright, so this is where we are for tonight. We got some of the gravel in. I need to come in. I'm going to take another sheet of plastic of this shower board, and because there's a mole hole or groundhog hole or whatever that we discovered that's dug in over there, it kind of comes in, comes around back over this way. So as this fills up with water, it goes into the hole and circles back around there. So I'm going to go ahead and get another sheet of this plastic, and I'm going to put it in here and swoop it around to somewhere around this far, so to extend it on back around. And then which is very simple, I just dig this rock back some, slip the shower board down in, and then put the rock back, and it'll be on the inside. And I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing with this corner here too. There's no water, as you can see, it's dry over on this side. There's no leak or anything on there, but I'm going to do it anyway. Probably take this little nub out right here, run the shower board from here, run it around and curve it around here, down here too. But it is working and looking good so far. And we just got the stop the leak off it on this side, so that's all we got left. And we'll go take care of that tomorrow. We have to go run an errand. Addie got a text from a friend saying that she's gonna be home tonight, and we gotta go over, give her a hand with something. So we're at a pretty decent stopping point now. We're gonna go ahead and let's see how this works overnight, and we'll come back tomorrow. And besides, even if we did stay here and finish that up, we still wouldn't have time to run the pipeline down to the freshwater tank anyway. So this is going to be a two-day job, no matter how you look at it anyhow. So, alrighty, we will talk to you tomorrow. Okay, so what I want to show you what we've been working on today is the spring. And here it is. Now, we haven't started on finishing the spring head right here because we wanted to get the pipeline laid before it rained, and it's been real cloudy all day, although this afternoon it seems to clear up and the sun started coming out. But this morning when we woke up and we started working, it was threatening to rain, so we wanted to get the pipeline glued together and whatnot before the rain came, because I can work on this spring head all day long without worrying about rain. So what we got here is we got our, basically it is a 3-liter bottle cut to the proper angle and everything that we need, and stuck in there, and it has a stocking on it for now, and it's currently, that particular one is temporary, and until we get a better screen on there. But then we have a 1 1/4 outer diameter and a 1 1/4 or 1 inch inner diameter, 1 1/4 inch outer diameter. The let me take the lid off of this bottle here real quick. The inner diameter of a 3-liter bottle is 1 1/4 inch. The outer diameter of this vinyl hose is 1 1/4 inch. So it slips in there perfect fit, nice and snug. You don't have to glue it or anything. And then it goes and it snakes down. It's about 6 feet of vinyl hosing. It goes and snakes down and around. Comes down here, connects to our pipeline via this joint here. And then we have 20 feet of 1-inch piping that goes from that point. Well, I guess it'd be 26 feet because we have the vinyl tubing is 1-inch tubing as well. So we got basically 26 feet of piping, but it's actually 2 10-foot lengths of 1-inch piping. When it gets to this joint here, and I'm gonna crawl under these logs real quick. Oh, this is really hard. Okay, there we go. At that joint there, we have a reducer that brings it down to 20 feet of 3/4 inch piping. Okay? After 20 feet of 3/4 inch piping, we have another reducer that takes it to the rest of the pipeline is 1/2 inch. And the reason why we go from, drop it from 1 inch to 3/4 inch to 1/2 inch is because we want to increase the pressure as it drops in elevation, because we have a short rise over here of a couple of feet that we have to go up. And the top of our water tank and the head of our spring and the top of our water tank are within 1 or 2 feet elevation of each other. Although we're coming down in the spring, the spring cuts this creek coming down here, actually drops it way down in elevation for the creek. But the actual head of the spring and the head of the tank are pretty close to level, plus or minus a foot.
Maybe 2 feet up, maybe.
And this in the spring head might actually be about 2 feet taller than the water tank. And what is special about that is that if you remember my water tube level, or my water levels using a water tube, you'll notice that water wants to be level at both ends of the tube or pipeline. No matter, as long as the pipeline or water tube is less than the length of the curvature of the earth. The curvature of the earth is 5 miles. So if your tube is less than 5 miles long, the water will always be level and elevation on each end. It'll be perfectly level. So if the spring head is slightly higher than the water tank, then the pipeline on both ends will, the water will naturally want to rise to the level of the tank. So we don't, we, The only reason why we're pressurizing it is because we're actually running and laying the pipeline to follow down along the creek, and which is actually...
Instead of digging a trench
and laying it and everything else, also, it's because we don't want to just level the water with the tank. We want to fill the tank. So by the time the water and pipeline got to the tank, it would just level off. And what we want to actually do is we want to create a whirlpool in the tank. So we want to pressurize it, which is why we used, started off with 1 inch and we came down to 1/2 inch. Right about here, we start leveling the pipe off with the, we kind of eyeballed leveled it and level the pipe off so that the creek continues downhill. And if we continued the pipe down the hill, it would drop way below elevation of the tank. So we started bringing it up the side of the creek here. And this is where it's gonna get tricky for me to climb up, so.
You want me to hold the camera while you climb?
That should be fine, I got the trees here. I can only hold onto the tree with one hand anyway. So here we got the 1/2 inch pipe. Now we still got to come in. We have temporarily put in these wooden stakes, but we're going to come in and put in some metal stakes here to hold the pipe in line, so that because these wooden ones will eventually corrode and you know decompose and whatnot. So we're going to put in some metal stakes to hold it in place because there's tension on them right now because we have. We didn't use any elbows or joints in this, so we have just using 1/2 inch pipe, it allows you to bring a curvature.
Flexible.
So we got the curve up, even though it looks like we're going up a hill here, which we are, keep in mind that the spring head over there is approximately level with the tank over here, so it doesn't matter what your tube does. Now I want to show you something over here. To show that it does work, here is the end of the pipe.
There's the water coming out of it.
And as you can see, there's approximately 3 to 4 gallons per minute of water flowing out of here. So this is our spring water. And we haven't hooked it up yet. We will have to disconnect it from the spring head and so that we can finish connecting it to our tank over here. But the reason why we didn't connect it up to the tank first is because one, we needed to hook it up and make sure it was going to flow properly. Two, there's dirt and stuff in the line from gluing it all together and whatnot. So we wanted to make sure that it got a good flushing of the pipe so we get all the contaminants and the dirt out of there and Addy's fingers out of there. You can see that there's pretty decent pressure on there. Can you put your hand on the other side so we can see the water on this side? So you can see, there's actually decent pressure out of there. Look at that. Check that out.
I'm not gonna pressure wash the car or anything like that, but it's
definitely... They definitely get a decent shower out of that. Not quite enough pressure to get it to the cabin, but definitely enough pressure, more than enough pressure to get it to the tank.
And swirl.
And get it to swirl and pressurize enough to agitate the water in the tank for sure. So next step now is, we're going to, can you disconnect that? Is to connect this pipe over there and carve a hole in here because the pipe's going to come in straight into the side right here. I had thought about bringing it in and doing an angle going in to the top of the tank, but I've decided that I'm going to come right into, because of the way that the pipe is laying, I'm gonna bring it right in across here and go straight in through the side of the tank as high up as I can get it and without messing with the curvature of the tank. I'm gonna come right into the side right here and then we will push the pipe into the tank enough so that we can glue it into that joint over there. But of course we have to stop to disconnect it from the spring so that the water stops flowing and then we can glue the pipe together, hook it up here and then reconnect it and get it going. One thing you want to know about when you're hooking up the, when you have a dry, empty pipe, when you hook it up to the spring for the first time, there's a lot of air in that pipe and it's going to want to bubble up and at the spring head. So it's basically, it's going to do a lot of burping and all the all the air in the pipe is going to fight its way up the pipe to the spring head, and the water is going to be fighting its way down.
Or you got to push it through.
Yeah. Or you have to apply a pump and push it through. But if you just hook the spring up and let it go, it'll eventually push the air out, and gravity will move it along. It took about probably, it's running, I think, let's see, 80, and 1, 2, 3, 110, and then 1, 2, 3, 130. To this point here is about 130, 140 feet of pipe, and it's, see, how many did I get here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 140 feet of pipe is laid here, plus the 6-inch of tubing. So you got 146, 150 feet, somewhere around there, of piping. It took about 20 minutes, 15 to 20 minutes for the water to actually push the air out and clean the pipe out to get it to come running through here. So don't expect to hook it up and have instant water coming out the end. There you have it, working great and nice. Come over here, I'm gonna show you the height it's pushing up this hill. There it is, pushing up the hill. It's only coming up about 2 feet, maybe 2.5 feet, because when it comes along the wall here, we start leveling from the up there and we level it out and bring it up, and it curves around. All those trucks going by because they have the construction work they're doing down the road. So soon the construction work will be over and those trucks won't be here anymore. Anyway, alrighty, we're losing water and daylight, so we're gonna get this done. Okay, so I've cut the hole here and we've got the pipe temporarily in there. We need to seal this off, obviously. We're gonna do that later. We have to go and to the store. Now that we know how it's gonna connect it to the pipe, we gotta go to the store and find a proper fitting to go on there. But that's how it's gonna go for now. Then we ran, this is a electrical conduit, and it's a 2.5-inch electrical conduit that we just had laying around. And it's a Schedule 40 rivet PVC, and it is for above ground and underground. You see here, sunlight resistant, and capable of standing up to weight and stuff. You can stand on it and everything else. We put that pipe on it to protect the pipe as it comes through the section where all the compost is going to be. And it will be supported. It's not currently because we're not finished. But once we finish this joint there, we'll slide it all the way up to like that. And then I'll put a support block under here and all along it so that it's not putting pressure on the joint. But that is in case the compost is too heavy or something falls on it or whatnot. And I didn't have enough to like cover the entire pipeline for this above ground section, but got the camera. But I covered it for the areas that are most important to me. The sections here, here's another piece coming through here. As you can see, it goes through. This one's just a 2-inch pipe. Here's another 2.5-inch. Actually, this is a 2-inch pipe here. This is an 1.5-inch pipe, and then that's a 2.5-inch pipe there. Just random sections of electrical conduit pipe that I had left over, which is UV sunlight above ground stuff. Now this pipe here that I have here is also Schedule 40 PVC and can be used above ground or below ground. And this is for water pipe, for indoor, outdoor, above ground, below ground water piping. And it's also sunlight resistant and stuff too. It's just that this electrical conduit is real heavy duty stuff. And I wanted to put it, I had it laying around, I don't have any other use for it. So I decided I'm just gonna go ahead and put it over the pipe. And it just adds extra protection to the pipe. So hopefully if something falls on it, this pipe here will take the brunt force and we'll risk breaking that pipe before we break this one. Although this pipe will be very easy to fix and replace. Very simple if we needed to. So, Addie's over there. We had disconnected the spring head so that we could glue in that last section of pipe now that the pipe has been flushed and cleaned out. And I hear the water coming. Let's get down in here. Now we're gonna let the tank fill. When the tank is full, we'll flush the tank out. But I'm gonna bring the camera down in here. Hopefully it'll drop it. Hopefully you can see. There's water pouring in. And our tank is filling without the use of any water pumps or anything. Straight up gravity. With the using the knowledge of water levels, water tube levels and how they work, and using gravity pressure and downsizing the pipe as we go along. No electricity, no sunlight, no wind turbine, no pumps, no nothing. Just straight up spring, pipe, tank. That's it. And our tank is filling. That is a wonderful sound. There will be no fetching water this winter. All last winter, Addie and I had to go fetch water. And this winter, we won't have to. Now all I gotta do is, before we leave, we're gonna go out to eat and celebrate. We're gonna go over to Ponderosa and have a nice steak dinner and whatnot. But before we go, I gotta get our garden hose out and attach it to here and run it out down there so that the overflow will have a place to go. And yep, we'll be set. I'm gonna come down here, pull these blocks out and make sure the valve is open, because what I'm hoping is that now the next step is that hook up the garden hose so that the overflow is going. And I'm hoping by the time we get home or sometime tonight, that tank will fill up, because it's running about 3 to 4 gallons per minute and it's a 300 gallon tank. So do the math. I don't want to do it right now. My brain doesn't work fast enough to make this video short. So, but at some point today, this evening, this tank will be full, and then this pipe right here comes out from the bottom of the tank, and the weight of the water in the tank plus the fact that water wants to level, so this pipeline right here will want to level out with the water that's in the tank. And what that means is that, see that joint right there, the water that's in this tank is going to want to come out level, naturally level with the overflow valve. And that joint there, wherever the overflow valve levels out, is a couple inches below that joint. It's gonna naturally wanna level out with that joint. But the weight of the water in the tank is gonna push down and push down on that. So it's actually gonna push it up above that joint and bring it out somewhere along here. And if it can bring it out past this joint, that's when it drops in elevation. So hopefully, when this tank is full, it will level out to that joint. The pressure of it will bring it past that joint enough to bring it down to where it drops in elevation below the joint. And then we will see water pouring out this end here too. Now, granted, this piece of pipe right here won't be connected to it for very long. We just got it sitting here just in case it does pour out, because our pump is actually gonna be mounted right here. And this isn't glued on or anything. But once this is all set up and everything, I'm going to build a box that goes right here, and this is where our water pump goes. And so the weight of the water in the tank will push it to the water pump, and then the water pump's job is just to push it to the cabin, and that's it. It will be the only time there will ever be water in this line. This line will be empty from this line right here that's in my hand, runs to the cabin. And this line right here will be empty 24/7. There will never be water in this line unless we are filling the tank that's in the house. That's why we're not worried about it freezing. An empty pipeline won't freeze. The only pipeline that will have water in it would be from this point on. And this is all under the hot compost and will all be insulated. So we don't have to worry about it freezing because it's all going to be insulated underground. This whole top of all this right here is going to be buried underground once we're done. And so this line right here, when we turn the pump on, it will fill this pipeline and then fill the tank in the house. And when the tank inside the house is full, we turn the pump off and then this backwashes and empties, and there will be no standing water in this line. Moving water does not freeze, and empty pipelines don't freeze. So we won't have to worry about, that's why we don't have to worry about burying the pipelines below the frost level, because there's no standing water in it. The gray water line is the same concept. There's no standing water. The only time there's water in it is when the water's moving and being stored in the tank or being evaporated in the ponds down there, which are working very, very well, by I might add. So okay, gonna move on and go get my garden hose and go check on Addie. So what do you think, Ralph? Can you root for me? No? Too tired? You just say hello. How about sit? Sit. No, you don't want to sit either? Sit. Give me your paw. There you go. Good boy. Ralph approved. Okay, so this is the next day. It got too late. By the time the tank was filled, it got too late for me to come out here and show you because it was too dark for you to see. Plus, we had a bear. Our bear friend was back and he was running around right over there, and it was didn't want to be out here too long inspecting. But as you see, our spring comes in over there like I showed you earlier, and it filled up, and I don't know if you can see this black line on camera or not, but it filled up to the overflow valve, which the hose runs straight down through here and it's coming out there. And just as fast as the spring fills the tank, the overflow catches the overflow of it and drains it out. So what that means is that the water in the tank is constantly flowing. So let's see if I can open the tank here. There we go. Now, I don't know if you're gonna see it or not, but the tank, the water in the tank is actually being agitated by the pressure of the spring shooting out of the pipe over there, and the pressure that I was able to build. So the spring water shoots out of the tank, shoots across this way, and it's actually got a mild whirlpool effect, and it's actually agitating the tank just like I expected it to. Hopefully you can see that on the camera. And agitated water won't freeze, and it's flowing water as well. So as it the whole tank is full, we've got approximately, this mark right here is 1,000 liters. This mark right here is 225 gallons. So this mark right here is approximately, I think it's 250 gallons right here. So this is about 260 or 270 gallons, because this right here is 295, if I'm not mistaken. So this is about halfway between 250 and 295, so somewhere around 260, 270 approximately in the tank. And so this one tank right here, if we were to stop filling the tank, if for some reason our springs were to stop running, this one tank here will supply enough water for my wife and I, for the amount that my wife and I use in our house, it will supply enough water for 30 days. But the fact that our spring is continuously feeding it, the tank will never empty, so we won't ever have that issue. But if for some reason the spring were to stop, for whatever reason, we would have a 30-day supply of water. And then we could always turn off, like if for some reason the spring stopped running, we would have the 30-day supply of water here, and then we could catch it into this tank and recycle it, filter it, and reuse it. Because this is the gray water tank, it's the same size, so whatever amount this tank will hold, this one will hold, and we could recapture it and use it for other stuff. But I don't expect our spring to stop flowing anytime soon. It's been running nonstop since we've got here, and we've been here for over a year now, and it's actually hasn't changed or fluctuated too much at all. Not much more than no more than a gallon per minute rise or fall in its flow rate, which is pretty good. So it's actually pushing out close to about 10 gallons per minute, 8 to 10 gallons per minute, and so it one of the better springs in the neighborhood. And yep. So all that's left now is I just got to finish the spring head. I have to I have to disconnect the spring head so that it stops pumping water into the tank. That way I can come over here and I can put in the actual connector, because right now the pipe just pushes into the tank. So I got to disconnect the spring so the water stops flowing, and then I'll come over here and put in the actual connector piece so that it's attached properly. And once that's done, I will put a cap on the end of the hose so that the drain stops. I want to block off this so that the tank stays as full as possible. And I want to make sure that I block this off, because I don't want to drain any more water. And I'm going to turn off the ball cock valve down there. And then I've got the same kind of stuff that you shock a swimming pool with to clean it out real good. Potable water tank shock treatment system is what I've got. So I'm going to shock the tank, make sure the tank is pure and clean inside, and then I will drain it and then refill it from scratch, and then we will start using it inside the house. So I'm going to shock the tank. It was shocked last year before we started using the tank, but it sat for a while, and it sat for a while empty, and I just want to make sure that it's all safe and sound and clean. Plus the pipelines and everything have never been used before, and they sat outside in storage, so they may have some spiders or ants or creepy crawlies and stuff in them that got to crawl around, some dirt and dust and stuff too, before they got glued together and laid. So I want to shock the entire system and whatnot prior to actually pumping water into the cabin. So clean out the system, get it all nice and good and ready, and then we'll do that between today and tomorrow, and by this weekend we should be able to pump water and have flowing water to the cabin, and be all good and set to go. And all that's left, really, the only pieces that we need to do is get our pump has the ability to screw a hose to either end of the pump. So what we need to do is get the PVC pipe here, the end cap that goes on here that allows like the hose connector piece, and then that we can connect it to the pump, and that's all we got to do. And then obviously build a little box thing here for the pump to sit in. So everything's moving along. Yep. Once the tank is shocked, the pump is installed, then we start building up our compost on top of it. Really happy that this is done. We worked all summer, been working at it slowly all summer, getting it pieced together, and it's finally getting accomplished. Herbster Place One and his family came out and dug our trench for the most part. They did the hardest part, as far as I'm concerned. digging out the trench. So I want to say thank you to Herbster Place One and his family. I know I've said it many times already, but this long trench here, Addy and I, just we're going at it real slow, and that's what took up most of the summer, was getting the trench dug. Because with my back problems, it's really hard for me to dig. And they came out here and got that trench dug for me, so thank you guys. You did an excellent job. Got it done exactly the way I wanted it. No issues, no problems. It's perfect. Thank you. And we got that done, so now we were able to get the tanks installed. My neighbor donated the hay that I needed and for the insulation on the front. And my other neighbor's giving us the horse manure and everything to help us start our composting. That's great. Tractor Supply gave us the styrofoam blocks. And I purchased all the piping, purchased the water tanks and all the connectors and valves and all that kind of stuff. And we got our greenhouse up. Yep. This summer, even if this is all we got done this summer, I consider it a productive summer. However, it's not the only thing we got done. We also got a crap ton of wood stacked and piled. We got more work done on our driveway. We got a lot more work done in our inside our cabin. And just about ready for winter time. So this winter we will start working on putting the walls and the interior walls up in our cabin this winter. So look forward to that.